Hi, my name is Nikolai, and I'm a skier and a filmmaker.
I spend most of my time in nature doing fun stuff, just trying to straight line the steepest couloirs from the highest mountains to the deepest fjords. I'm going to find out how Norrøna produces their cool outdoor gear loaded with minimalism. Since 1929, Norrøna has been a family business making outdoor products with the highest possible quality. This is the story about their craftsmanship.
So I'm here in the Norrøna house. Grab my old jacket here, maybe get it fixed. Say hi to the ladies in the sewing room.
Hey, Jon. Du, jeg har med deg en gammel jakke med, som jeg håper du kanskje kan ta en titt på, for den har fått litt hard medfart opp igjen da.
Ja, det ser jeg. Men det vi gjør da, at vi syr på en nytt panel. Du kan se å syr utenpå den gamle.
Hallo, Nico.
Hei.
Ja, ja. Å, kan du parere jakken? Så kult da. Den ser bra ut.
Ja, det blir jævlig bra. Ja, ja. Under peilingen, vet du.
Ja.
This is JJ. Like his great-grandfather, grandfather, and father, he is the CEO of Norrøna. Jørgen has always been passionate about the outdoors. Like his ancestors, he's continued to push the boundaries through Norrøna's extreme user-driven development to make sure you have the best products to kit you up for your next adventure. And he loves his powder turns.
Ja, kan bare, jeg skal fortelle, jeg trenger mer enn en setning for å fortelle. Går det bra?
It's important for us to have a repair center since we make really high quality products that is timeless and that are supposed to last for many years. You're supposed to, if you take good care of them, you can use it really long time.
Norrøna has offered repair and service on all their products since 1929. These people believe in reduce, repair, reuse, remake and recycle. Norrøna has a repair center at the head office in Norway and in stores around the world. Last year, they repaired over 11,000 products. So if you have a beat-up, second-hand Norrøna piece laying around, send it in. From every aspect of POW adventures to ice-cold expeditions, mountaineering, biking, running, Arctic surf, and hunting, Norrøna makes products for all types of adventures. But how are these products actually made, Jørgen?
It all starts here, out in nature. Then we get all our ambassadors and product development team together and brainstorm on new products. And then in here, we do all the design of the products. We find or develop all the fabrics and materials for the products. Then we find or develop the right trims and zippers for the product. Then we digitally make the patterns, we cut them out, and it's ready to be sewn together to a full product. Here in our sewing lab, we make the prototypes. And then to get the clean look and nice finish, we do a lot of gluing and laminating. And then we put on the logo. And then we test it here in our lab. And then our products get tested by our ambassadors.
Then we create the marketing for our products in our studio.
And then after all the development, testing, production and quality control, the products ends up here in our stores so you can select whatever you like.
My great-grandfather, he was a saddle maker. And he actually started another company in 1918 with a companion. This company became quite successful. And he was not happy with the quality of this existing company. And he was not able to change the direction. So he actually pulled out. And in 1929, the 29th of April, he started Norrøna with the ambition of making the world's greatest outdoor products. The fundamental of Norrøna has been developing over years, even if the mission of Welcome to Nature has been there always, and making great outdoor products or the highest quality outdoor products was the first building block. And then in the 70s, when my father took over the company, he and Thomas Karlström, they started this extreme user-driven product development and they put in the second building stone, which is best function.
Thomas Karlström, one of Norrøna's biggest legends. This badass ice climber and mountaineer is possibly best known for his roles in Norrøna and Skandinavisk Høyfjellsutstyr. This enthusiastic amigo is a designer, photographer, visionary, and entrepreneur.
70 år har designat av gamascher, fjälljack, sommarfjälljacken I bomull, anoraken I bomull som jag snackade om, och fjällbuxer för skibruk.
The old chap is also the brains behind the iconic Ravneskar mountain tent. He also designed this legendary Hexentrix.
Fram till 1977, då fick vi besök av två amerikanska klättrare. Kanske var det en som världens bästa klippklättrare och också is, Henry Barber. Och han har med sig Rob Taylor, en skotsk amerikaner. De två var testteam för gårdfabriken och hade med sig hemliga Gore-Tex-plagg som de skulle testa. Och jag fick ju också testa det där och det fanskapet funket. Jag hade ryggsäcken på ryggsäcken där, då fick jag kondens på insidan under bärstropparna. Men inte på armarna och kläderna. Där var det tört. Fast det regnet ute så var jag törr på insidan alltså.
You know, a bit of the hippie movement and sort of this climbing development, wanting to do a lot of new expedition, this expedition trend in the 70s. And then you had some new materials coming in. It was just really a great setup to fantastic products.
Så fick jag Ole Jørgen till att ta kontakt med Gårdfabriken och köpte in några prövmeter av blått stoff och sydde upp tre jackor. Här har vi då ett av tre exemplar av Europas första Gore-Tex-plagg. Då betyder det här kunskapen och erfaringen och till de ambassadörerna enormt mycket för produktutvecklingen. Och för exempel som Stein Åsheim som då har varit med och hållit på så länge med allt från paddling till vart på toppen av Everest. Det är klart att den kunskapen som de folk har sitter inne med är guld värt för en producent.
And that, this is state of the art in the 60s.
Yeah. This was what it was all about. And this one was with me on Everest.
It looks so like medieval almost, you know what I mean?
I must admit the last times I've been using it in the garden to...
Stein P. Åsheim is extraordinary. He's been to Trango Tower back in 84, where his team made the first ascent of the Norwegian buttress. He's biked through the Sahara Desert, crossed the South Pole, sailed to Antarctica, skied through Svalbard, Greenland and Siberia, not to mention horseback riding through Mongolia, and the list goes on.
We were a small family during those years. When we went to Everest in 1985, there was maybe 15 Norwegians that were capable of doing Everest. Everybody knew each other who it would be, and we put up a list, the five climbers that we felt were the best, the most suitable ones to do Everest. Thomas and Jørgensen and Norrøna was kind of a part of the whole family, and we gave feedback. We talked to Thomas and we talked to Jørgensen, and then we got new products. We came home, we told them this didn't work and this was great. This is from, I think, Dragnagri in 1995.
Why the long steps?
They could have probably stopped up here, but we wanted to be able to take the pants off and on with the big boots.
What are all these?
These ones are from 1968. This is what we used. This was like the state of the art.
You know, they're still in style, actually.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Which works.
It looks great.
Yeah.
I think it was Robert who told me, like, the best alpinists are the ones with the shortest memory.
Yeah. Yeah, Robert is very good to explain those things. It doesn't seem like he meets that hell part of it when he is in situations where I believe this looks like hell, and he talks about it, and it seems like something different.
Robert Kaspersen. He may have some similarities to Pippi Longstocking in terms of strength, hair color, and rock and roll charisma. This man is a brilliant ski mountaineer, multi-pitch, big wall, ice, and alpine climber. Robert has numerous first ascents. For the past 20 years, he's been an ambassador and product developer for Norrøna.
I'm out there all the time, testing, wearing the clothing all the seasons, so...
Are you critical of bad stuff?
But I get bad conscience quite often because I receive samples of test progress and I like, I've been telling them for 15 years not to do it this way. I try to be a bit diplomatic, and I am afraid that I'm a bit too direct sometimes. Quite often there's a conflict between my demands and the market. Like Jørgen, he's been really central to this, of course.
In year 2000, when I started working in the company, we brought in the design element of really making greatest design. When you pay 500 euro for a Gore-Tex jacket, you want it to look damn good. We don't think about trends. We try to make our products timeless. And if you want really high quality, you need enough time to test it so you know it's working.
Maybe a pant can be one fabric on one leg and another fabric on the other leg to see how it wears and how it takes moist. So this is a really broad testing phase. And then we do this for 6 months, and then we have new samples, and we keep on going, and we have new meetings where we refine our ideas.
So before the product hits the market, it's already been tested for 3 full seasons, yes, pretty much, and refined, yes, every year,
yes,
before it ends up there in the store.
Exactly.
It's so cool, it's kind of like a painting, you know, you're like fixing it up.
Many paintings.
Norrøna also has many dedicated ambassadors. Thanks to all of them, Norrøna gets to test their products in extreme conditions, and their feedback is gold. They all play an important role in the creation of each concept, bringing the products to life through their passion, lifestyle, and core activity.
But why does it take 3 years to make a really good product? I mean, 3 years? That's a long time.
It's about knowledge. You know, I think if we don't have the pattern makers and the product technicians here that sold the product, we lose so much of the competence somewhere else. I think it's really, really hard to make high quality, innovative stuff if you don't have the craftsmen in-house.
One of the craftsmen working for Norrøna is this guy.
Good to see you, bud.
Brad Boren. Brad has been working at Norrøna for 20 years. Thanks to this guy, Norrøna is on the leaderboards of the 100% Club of Organic Cotton and the 100% Club of Preferred Down. Norrøna is also racing to the top with a number 2 on preferred wool and with a number 5 on recycled polyester.
Some years ago, we kind of said that it wasn't that important to kind of show everything. You know, we actually just tried to do the right thing. Very Norwegian, you know, that you kind of do the right things and you don't talk about it. And me being American, I was like really careful not to talk too much and just to make sure we were doing good things. So we would spend money on recycled fabrics, and we'd spend money on organic cotton, but we didn't really spend money to kind of prove that they were organic or that it was recycled. So over the years, we've been actually spending more money on joining Blue Sign and joining other organizations and making sure all of our products are third-party verified. And the main reason is this allows us to show that it's actually being done, the things that we're paying for. So I think it's really important as our brand to be transparent.
You know, it comes from the start with making the highest quality products. That's the most sustainable thing you can do. But sustainability is even more critical today. And to change everything into a process where there's no carbon footprint is what we work on. That's the 4 building blocks in the bottom of everything we do at Norrøna.
Deeply rooted in the Norwegian way of living close to nature, Norrøna values craftsmanship, innovation, function, and long-lasting quality. Thanks to all the ambassadors and 120 employees with 18 different nationalities, the family-owned outdoor company has one mission: to make everyone able to get out there. Welcome to nature.